From New York, this is Democracy Now!
At the end of the day, now we're forced to live in a state where a United States citizen will have to choose between putting food on their kid's plate or voting.
A federal appeals court has blocked hundreds of thousands of Floridians with fees and fines from past felony convictions from registering to vote in a move that could determine this year's presidential race. We'll look at the attack on voting rights across the country from Wisconsin to Florida. Then, as fires continue to devastate the West Coast, Trump rejects climate science and blames the fire solely on forest management.
Please remember the words, very simple. Forest management, please remember that.
We'll speak to an indigenous fire expert in California who studied how a return to indigenous ways of caring for the land could foster greater climate resiliency. And as Amazon CEO Jeff Bezos becomes the first person in the world to be worth $200 billion, we'll look at how Amazon increased profits by price gouging during the pandemic, marking up products by as much as 1,000%. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Nearly 90 wildfires continue to ravage the West Coast, where over 5 million acres have already been scorched. San Francisco, Seattle, and Portland have the worst air quality of any major city in the world. Hazy conditions from the fires have spread as far as New York and Washington, D.C. President Trump was in California Monday, where he was challenged by California's Natural Resources Secretary Wade Crowfoot over his denial of climate change.
If we ignore that science and sort of put our head in the sand and think it's all about vegetation management, we're not going to succeed together protecting Californians.
Okay. It'll start getting cooler.
You just watch. I wish science agreed with you.
Hey, well, I don't think science knows, actually.
Well, I don't think science knows, actually, Trump said. In Delaware, Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden slammed Trump as a climate arsonist.
If you give a climate arsonist 4 more years in the White House, why would anyone be surprised if we have more America ablaze?
In related news, Oregon prisoners report being pepper sprayed by guards after they were evacuated due to the wildfires, making it even more difficult to breathe amidst the smoke and the air pollution. We'll have more on the record-shattering wildfires later in the broadcast. The total number of global COVID-19 infections has topped 29 million, with nearly 930,000 dead. The CEO of the world's largest vaccine manufacturer, Serum Institute of India, has told the Financial Times it might take up to 5 years to vaccinate everyone in the world once a COVID-19 vaccine is approved if it's a two-dose vaccine. In other COVID-19 news, infection levels are spiking in the Midwest as North Dakota, South Dakota, Missouri, and Iowa report record levels of infections. In New York City, at least 55 public school staff have recently tested positive for COVID-19. One New York City public school in the Bronx was forced to close temporarily before students even entered the building for the new school year after 2 coronavirus cases were confirmed there. Meanwhile, the American Academy of Pediatrics and Children's Hospital Association is estimating nearly 550,000 children in the United States have tested positive for the virus since the beginning of the pandemic. This comes as the U.S. death toll approaches 195,000, the highest in the world by far. On Monday, CNN aired new audio from journalist Bob Woodward from an interview he did with President Trump on April 13th. At the time, Trump was publicly urging the U.S. economy be reopened, but privately, Trump compared COVID-19 to the plague.
This thing is a killer if it gets you. If you're the wrong person, you don't have a chance.
Yes, yes, exactly. This is a monster. This is a scourge. And
it is the plague.
4 days after President Trump said those words to Bob Woodward in April, he sent out tweets calling on supporters to, quote, liberate the states of Michigan, Minnesota and Virginia, sparking a series of protests against COVID-19 lockdowns. Meanwhile, the city of Henderson, Nevada, has issued a $3,000 fine to the venue that hosted a large indoor Trump rally over the weekend for violating Nevada's COVID-19 guidelines. Thousands attended the event. Most did not wear masks. A local reporter asked Trump if he was concerned about getting infected.
Aren't you concerned about getting COVID, though, in an enclosed
room? No, I'm not concerned. I'm more concerned about how close you are, to be honest.
Sorry about that.
Because you know why? I'm on a stage that's very far away, and so I'm not at all concerned.
He said he wasn't concerned because he was able to socially distance. The thousands of people inside the Henderson facility were closely closely next to each other and not wearing masks. A federal appeals court ruled Monday the Trump administration can end immigration protections for some 400,000 people under the Temporary Protected Status Program. Nationals with TPS from El Salvador, Haiti, Nicaragua, and Sudan could be subject to deportation starting next year, some as early as January. Many TPS recipients have been living in the U.S. for decades and have children who are U.S. citizens. Plaintiffs say they'll appeal the ruling. The National TPS Alliance is launching a cross-country Journey for Justice caravan next week. A nurse at a Georgia Immigration and Customs Enforcement prison says the Irwin County Detention Center is performing hysterectomies on prisoners without their consent. Project South sent the explosive whistleblower account to the Department of Homeland Security and the Office of the Inspector General. One jailed migrant recounted, quote, "When I met all these women who had had surgeries, I thought this was like an experimental concentration camp. It was like they're experimenting with our bodies," unquote. Nurse Dawn Wooten, the whistleblower, also described neglect and undertesting for COVID-19 at the jail, which is run by the for-profit LaSalle Corrections. Palestinians in Gaza and the West Bank are holding a day of rage to protest the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain's move to become the first Arab countries to normalize relations with Israel in over 25 years. President Trump, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, and officials from the UAE and Bahrain are meeting today at the White House to sign the agreements. Over the weekend, the Palestinian factions of Hamas and Fatah agreed on forming a, quote, unified field leadership to lead a joint resistance against the Israeli occupation. A boat carrying refugees capsized off the coast of Libya in the Mediterranean, leaving at least 24 people dead or missing. At least 45 people survived. The UN called out the restrictions imposed on NGOs by European nations, including unnecessary and long standoffs at sea. Over 400 refugee deaths have been recorded so far this year in the Mediterranean Sea. In Greece, thousands of refugees remain without shelter 1 week after the burning down of the massive, overcrowded Moria encampment. Some 13,000 people were left homeless. Many still do not have access to running water or food and are unable to leave the Isle of Lesbos. Many are also refusing to go to a new camp set up by Greek authorities, saying they do not trust the new facility. Refugees have been holding protests over their conditions and pleading for help from other European nations. Over the weekend, police fired tear gas at the demonstrators. A Human Rights Watch report found that Belarusian security forces arbitrarily detained thousands of people and tortured or mistreated hundreds in the crackdown following last month's presidential election. Despite the reports of violence, another 100,000 people took to the streets of the capital Minsk again Sunday to demand the resignation of President Alexander Lukashenko. Police again attacked and arrested hundreds of protesters. On Monday, Russian President Vladimir Putin said he would loan $1.5 billion to Lukashenko to help stave off an economic crisis as he attempts to retain his grip on power. In Germany, Russian opposition leader Alexei Navalny has posted on Instagram a picture of himself from his hospital bed after coming out of an induced coma. Navalny, a vocal critic of Russian President Vladimir Putin, was poisoned last month while on a flight in Siberia. In Japan, Yoshihide Suga is expected to become Japan's new prime minister after winning the ruling Liberal Democratic Party's leadership contest in a landslide Monday. Suga is expected to take up his predecessor Shinzo Abe's push to revise parts of Japan's pacifist constitution. Suga supported laws allowing the military to join combat operations with Japanese allies. He's also seen as one of the most pro-immigration politicians in Japan. A large chunk of ice twice the size of the island of Manhattan has broken off the Arctic's largest remaining ice shelf in Greenland. Last month, scientists said Greenland's ice sheet has shrunk past the point of return. In related news, U.S. government scientists said this summer broke the record for hottest ever in the Northern Hemisphere. In Brazil, thousands of fires in the world's largest wetland have scorched more than 5.8 million acres of some of the planet's most biodiverse land. The fires in the Brazilian Pantanal are often set to clear land for logging and farming, but have been exacerbated by severe climate change-fueled drought. Conservationists say historic fires this year have caused a devastating loss of wildfire, including endangered species, as animals, including jaguars, rare birds, and reptiles, have been charred or starved to death. Hurricane Sally is approaching the Gulf Coast, threatening potentially lethal flooding and storm surges for just the second time ever recorded. And the first time in nearly half a century, five tropical cyclones have formed simultaneously in the Atlantic Ocean. A University of Delaware professor, a known climate change denier, has been tapped for a top position at NOAA. That's the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration. David LaGates has written papers calling for more fossil fuel emissions and has had his work supported by the Robert Mercer-funded Heartland Institute and Koch Industries, as well as major gas and oil companies. In a Facebook live stream, Health and Human Services spokesperson Michael Caputo claimed without evidence that armed left-wing militants are preparing for insurrection after the election and that gun owners should stock up on ammunition. He said Joe Biden would refuse to concede the election and that, quote, when Donald Trump refuses to stand down at the inauguration, the shooting will begin. Caputo also spewed conspiracy theories related to the coronavirus pandemic, accusing government scientists of sedition against Trump and members of the CDC of forming an anti-Trump resistance unit within the CDC to undermine Trump. Separately, Michael Caputo went on a Twitter rampage in which he called for tear-gassing reporters, among other things. His account appeared to have been disabled on Monday. Meanwhile, House Democrats say they're investigating a recent report that political appointees at HHS, including Michael Caputo, have reviewed and altered weekly coronavirus reports from the Centers for Disease Control in order to support Trump's optimistic messaging about the pandemic. A federal judge has blocked the Trump administration from enforcing new asylum restrictions after it ruled Chad Wolf is likely serving unlawfully as acting secretary of the Department of Homeland Security. The House Homeland Security Committee subpoenaed Wolf to testify this week over whistleblower allegations that he told HHS officials to alter intelligence. And eight people were arrested in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, on Monday as protesters took to the streets following the fatal police shooting of 27-year-old Ricardo Munoz. Police also used tear gas and rubber bullets on crowds. Body camera footage shows a police officer shooting Munoz, who's holding a knife after responding to a domestic disturbance complaint. Munoz's family said he suffered from schizophrenia and paranoia. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York, joined by my co-host Juan Gonzalez at his home in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, Monday marked 50 days until the November election, and we begin today's show looking at the attack on voting rights across the United States. In a pivotal decision that could give Democratic presidential candidate Joe Biden a big boost in Wisconsin, the state Supreme Court rejected an appeal by the Green Party's candidate, Howie Hawkins, to invalidate thousands of already mailed ballots so that they could be reprinted with his name on them. In a 4-3 decision Monday, a conservative justice split with the right-wing majority and allowed Wisconsin's voting process to proceed as planned. The ruling comes just days before the start of mail-in voting in the state. Hawkins called it a, quote, travesty of justice. Meanwhile, in Iowa, a judge sided with Republican incumbent Donald Trump's presidential campaign and voided more than 90,000 absentee ballot requests in the state's most Democratic-leaning county. Johnson County is now the third Iowa county to have its ballot request forms voided because county election officials mailed the forms to voters with personal information filled in to simplify the process. Affected voters will either have to fill out a new blank form to request an absentee ballot or vote at the polls on Election Day in the midst of the pandemic. In Colorado, a federal judge just upheld a temporary restraining order that stops the U.S. Postal Service from sending out mailers that the state's attorney general says have incorrect election information on them. The list of major developments goes on. From Pennsylvania, where election officials are not able to send out ballots due to a slew of lawsuits and other issues, to Florida, where a court on Friday blocked hundreds of thousands of people with fees and fines from past felony convictions from registering to vote. From all on all of this, as well as concerns about a sabotage census, we're joined by Ari Berman, senior writer at Mother Jones, reporting fellow at the Tite Media Center, author of Give Us the Ballot, The Modern Struggle for Voting Rights in America. His latest piece is titled Conservative Judicial Decisions Keep Boosting GOP Voter Suppression. Welcome back to Democracy Now, Ari. Let's start in Florida. Can you talk about what has happened there?
Good morning, Amy, and good morning, Juan. It was a really pivotal decision in Florida because in 2018, 64% of Floridians approved a law restoring voting rights to people with past felony convictions. Before that, Florida prevented 1 in 10 people, including 1 in 5 African Americans, from voting. Then the GOP legislature said that people with past felony convictions have to pay off all fines, fees, and restitution to be able to vote, which the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals, which now has a Trump majority because Trump appointed 5 justices to that court, upheld that law. What it means in practice is that, according to studies, 775,000 people in Florida still owe money on their sentences and might not be able to vote. And remember, Amy, this was a state decided by 537 votes in 2000. So we're talking about hundreds of thousands of people maybe not being able to vote in Florida, who should have had their rights restored in a state that's been decided by only a few hundred votes in the past.
I want to go to Desmond Meade, who is the one who was the author of Amendment 4 that was overwhelmingly passed. We spoke with him yesterday. He's president of the Florida Rights Restoration Coalition and chair of the Floridians for a Fair Democracy about his response to the ruling.
We're definitely viewing the recent decision by the 11th Circuit as a blow to democracy. I think democracy is the biggest loser here. You know, at the end of the day, now we're forced to live in a state where a United States citizen will have to choose between putting food on their kids' plate or voting. You know, choose between paying rent or their mortgage and voting. And this is not what democracy is all about. And so Florida Rights Restoration Coalition, we as an organization remain committed, in spite of this recent ruling, to continue our efforts to engage as many returning citizens as possible through our fines and fees funds, where we've had patriots, defenders of democracy across the country donating money so we are able to help people pay off their legal financial obligations and get them registered to vote so they can be able to participate in what we feel to be the most important presidential election this country has ever seen.
So that's Desmond Meade, the force behind Amendment 4 that was overwhelmingly passed in Florida, that gave over 1 million people who had served time in prison for felonies the right to vote. Can you talk about the significance of him saying millions of dollars are available? How do people find out about this, Ari?
That's right. The Florida Rights Restoration Coalition, led by Desmond Meade, has a fund that's raised $3 million to pay off people's fines and fees so people can go to their website and donate to that. The big problem in Florida right now, Amy, is this law passed by the legislature is kind of like a poll tax meets a literacy test. And I'll explain why. It's like a poll tax because you have to pay to be able to vote now. You have to be able to pay off all the fines, fees, and restitution you owe to be able to vote, which could be tens of thousands of dollars, hundreds of thousands of dollars, or even millions of dollars. It's like a literacy test because Florida can't actually tell you how much money you owe. There is no centralized database in Florida for someone with a past felony conviction to go to see whether they still owe money. So this is really incomprehensible to people. Florida set up a law that it actually can't enforce. And that's why it's going to lead to mass voter confusion, potentially mass voter disenfranchisement. And it's just incredible to me that the court would uphold something like this just a few months before the election that so brazenly overturns the will of the voters who approved this historic ballot initiative in 2018.
And Ari, has there been any, is there any data about how many people have had their right to vote restored of former convicted felons?
Yes, there has been one. 85,000 people have had their rights restored so far, and they are still eligible to vote. So that is one good thing about the decision, is that it still allows those 85,000 people that have had their rights restored to be able to vote. But we're talking about 1.4 million people who are set to have their rights restored. So you're talking about 85,000 people have had their rights restored, but there's still hundreds of thousands of people that have not had their rights restored. And the question is, will they be eligible to vote? Will they decide to vote? Or even if they don't owe money, will they be dissuaded from voting because of what the legislature did and what the courts upheld? So it's just a really unfortunate situation, because I think that Florida voters made it very clear that they wanted people to be able to vote if they've paid their debt to society. The legislature added this crazy new wrinkle saying you had to pay off all your fines, fees, and restitution. And the only reason it was upheld was because Donald Trump flipped the 11th Circuit with five Trump judges. And this is why Mitch McConnell and the Republican Senate is so intent on confirming judges and doing nothing else. This week, McConnell is going to confirm eight more judges to the federal bench, but they're not doing anything else to help the American people.
And Ari, can we switch to Wisconsin and the situation there with the court decision on the Green Party? Could you explain why it went down to the wire for even the court to consider this case, given that the election is only 50 days away?
It went down to the wire in Wisconsin because the Green Party filed late to try to get on the ballot. So there was a dispute first with the Wisconsin Elections Commission of whether they should be on the ballot. And then the question was, should they delay sending hundreds of thousands of ballots to put the Green Party on the ballot? And the Wisconsin Supreme Court basically said, we're not deciding this on the merits of whether they should be on the ballot. It's just too late to add them to the ballot. Tens of thousands of ballots have already gone out. Hundreds of thousands of more are going out this week. There's been over a million absentee ballot requests in Wisconsin. And this week is the day that they start sending them out en masse. So I think this decision adding the Green Party to the ballot would have led to major voter confusion in Wisconsin, and that a lot of people who got a ballot would have had to then get another one. And there was a risk that they would be very confused, that some people might vote twice or some people might not vote at all. So irrespective of the merits of whether the Green Party should be on the ballot, I think election officials in Wisconsin are breathing a sigh of relief that they don't have to print new ballots and they can send the ballots that have already been requested out on time.
And what about the situation in Iowa with there? What was the personal information that the court felt, that officials felt should not have been on the ballot? Could you talk about that and why specifically in Democratic counties?
What happened was in Iowa, the Democratic counties in particular decided to, on their own, send absentee ballot requests to voters. So in places like Cedar Rapids and Iowa City, the Democratic auditors decided to send these ballots. To make it easier, they filled in personal information because Iowa passed a new voter ID law. And one of the provisions of that law is you have to have a PIN for your driver's license on your absentee ballot. And a lot of people don't know what that number is. So the auditors tried to make this process easier for voters by filling in the information, including their driver's license PIN number, which nobody knows what that is. And instead of saying, hey, thank you for making it easier for people to vote, in response to a lawsuit by the Trump campaign, the courts have now invalidated absentee ballot requests in the most Democratic counties in the state. So this is very confusing for voters, because imagine that you requested an absentee ballot, and now you think you're getting one in the mail, and now you're going to have to get do that whole process over again 50 days or less before the election. And so it just adds more uncertainty into the process. And people are already confused about how to vote in this election. And these court decisions making it harder to vote are not helping.
So, Ari, talk also about Pennsylvania. I mean, it seems like across the country, if the Republican Party sues, it simply delays absentee ballots from going out, even if they're going to ultimately lose. So talk about what's happening in Pennsylvania. Then in Colorado, if you could explain what's happening there, a federal judge ordering the U.S. Postal Service to immediately stop sending mailers that contain false information, and then talk about McConnell and the U.S. Postal Service.
So first off, in Pennsylvania, there's a ton of litigation right now. The Trump campaign is litigating, for example, to try to prevent voters from dropping off their ballots at drop boxes to avoid postal delays. There's disputes over whether you should be able to start counting mail ballots before the election. Right now, you can't, which means it could take longer for the votes to count. And actually, Republicans are refusing to allow votes to be counted earlier because they want uncertainty in terms of the process. So there's a lot of litigation in Pennsylvania. Ballots have not gone out there either. And this is, of course, a really pivotal swing state. In Colorado, what happened was the post office sent mailers to all 50 states, basically telling people, if you request an absentee ballot, request it early. The problem in Colorado is that you don't have to request an absentee ballot, that they actually automatically send ballots to all registered voters. They also can turn around ballots quicker because it's a vote by mail state. So what election officials were angry about in Colorado and other states is that the post office sent this one-size-fits-all mailer to all voters as opposed to making it state-specific, because the voting laws in Colorado are very different than the voting laws in New York. And election officials told the post office, this is going to confuse voters. This is going to end up being a form of voter suppression. The post office didn't listen. Now there's an injunction against them. In terms of what Mitch McConnell's doing, the only thing he is doing in Washington right now is confirming more federal judges for Donald Trump. He's confirmed over 200 federal judges for Donald Trump. He's been blocking $25 billion for the post office for over 120 days. He has been blocking legislation to restore the Voting Rights Act for over 280 days. He has been blocking legislation to prevent foreign election interference for over 320 days. He's not doing anything for the American people. The only thing Mitch McConnell is doing right now is confirming more extreme right-wing judges for Donald Trump, because that's the way Republicans rig the electoral system. If they get the judges they want, then they can uphold things like modern-day poll taxes in Florida. So this is the Republican Party's game. Don't do anything for the American people. Make it as hard as you can to vote, and then put in place judges who will then uphold those new voter suppression laws.
Ari, I wanted to ask you about the bigger picture of this national move, especially because of the pandemic, toward the mail-in voting. You know, those of us who have covered elections in this country for decades know that the old system had many, many problems in terms of being able to deliver a clear count on election day. But clearly, the move to mail-in balloting, especially given that every jurisdiction, every state, sometimes every county have their own methods, will mean it inevitably that we're going to have many, many more problems in terms of being able to actually count votes, not to mention the fact that there will be a lot of people whose ballots will be discounted because they didn't properly fill out the mail-in ballot. So I'm wondering if you could step back and give us a big picture of what to expect come election day.
Well, it makes sense that in a pandemic, a lot of people would want to vote by mail, but people have to be careful about mail voting. There were over 500,000 mail ballots rejected in the primaries, which was a major increase from 2016 because ballots arrived too late, or people didn't sign them correctly, or they didn't sign them at all. And so there's a lot of concern with mail voting that while it is a safe way to vote in a pandemic, if you're not careful, these ballots can be rejected at a higher rate than in-person voting. So I think if you vote by mail, you have to do it early. You have to send it back early or drop it off if possible. You have to sign it and sign it carefully. I think if people are proactive about mail voting, there won't be problems. But if everyone decides to vote by mail at the last minute, and election officials are overwhelmed, if the post office, which has been sabotaged by Donald Trump, is overwhelmed, there could be real problems with mail voting and a real chance of major voter disenfranchisement. What Republican legislatures are also doing in states like Wisconsin and Minnesota and Pennsylvania is they are not allowing the officials to start counting the ballots before Election Day, which means that it's going to take longer to count the ballots. And Donald Trump is going to say, oh, only the Election Day vote should count. Let's disqualify all of the mail ballots. But if you want to avoid that kind of situation, what the Republican legislatures need to do in Michigan and Wisconsin and Pennsylvania is say that people should start counting the votes earlier, then it won't take weeks to certify the winner. We'll know who won the election, maybe not on election night, but in a relatively quick period of time. So Republicans are trying to capitalize on the uncertainty and fear around mail voting to try to boost their efforts to make it harder to vote.
I wanted to switch the issue to the census, and we only have a minute to go, but a federal court in New York blocked the Trump administration from excluding undocumented immigrants from the 2020 census, ruling undocumented people, quote, qualify as persons in a state who must be counted. Advocates called the ruling a victory for voting and immigrant rights. This comes as federal judge in California's temporarily halted the Trump administration from ending its census collection efforts a month early, pending a court hearing later this month. The Census Bureau is being challenged by a coalition of rights groups, local governments, and Native American communities after it announced it would end its collection efforts at the end of September instead of the end of October, which could lead to a vast undercount of immigrants and communities of color. If you could talk about the significance of this, Ari Berman.
The Trump administration has been trying to sabotage the census from day one. Luckily, federal courts and the Supreme Court have pushed back on this. The problem is that there's a lot of fear among people, particularly immigrant communities, that they shouldn't respond to the census. And if you look at the numbers, the response rate in 2020 is lower than the response rate in 2010 and 2000, and very low in some immigrant communities, very low on tribal reservations, where fewer than 20% of people have responded. So time is running out. The count is either going to end at the end of this month or the end of next month. And the implications are huge. We're talking about $1.5 trillion in federal funding for the next decade. We're talking about how state and federal voting districts are drawn. We're talking about how much electoral votes and representation states receive. So we only get a chance to do this once every decade. And it would be a real shame if we had a deliberate undercount of certain communities, particularly immigrant communities and communities of color, to try to benefit the Trump administration's aims as opposed to benefiting all of society, which is what the census is supposed to do. It's supposed to count everyone and serve everyone, not just a shrinking white minority represented by Donald Trump.
Ari Berman, want to thank you for being with us. Senior writer at Mother Jones, author of Give Us the Ballot, The Modern Struggle for Voting Rights in America. We'll link to your latest piece, Conservative Judicial Decisions Keep Boosting GOP Voter Suppression. Then as fires continue to devastate the West Coast, Trump rejects climate science. We'll go to California to speak with an indigenous fire expert about how return to indigenous ways of caring for the land could foster greater climate resiliency. Stay with us. Joe Cuba here on Democracy Now!, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez as we turn to the West Coast, where wildfires fueled by the climate crisis have burned more than 5 million acres, dark in the skies from Canada to Mexico with smoke and ash. As nearly 90 wildfires burned, Portland marked the worst air quality of any major city in the world Monday, with San Francisco, Seattle, and Los Angeles not far behind. Hazy conditions from the fires have spread as far as New York and Washington, D.C. The fires have killed at least 35 people, forced mass evacuations, dozens are missing, laid bare the reality of changing climate. But on Monday, President Trump continued to deny the climate crisis in exchange with California's Natural Resources Secretary Wade Crowfoot.
If we ignore that science and sort of put our head in the sand and think it's all about vegetation management, we're not going to succeed together protecting Californians.
Okay. It'll start getting cooler.
You just watch. I wish science agreed with you.
Hey, well, I don't think science knows, actually.
I don't think science knows, actually, Trump said. Well, California Governor Gavin Newsom also addressed President Trump, who's repeatedly blamed the fires in California on forest management.
There's no question when you look past this decade and looking past almost 1,000-plus years that we have not done justice on our forest management. I don't think anyone disputes that. And final point, I'd be negligent, and this is not, and we've known each other too long, and as you suggest, the working relationship I value. We obviously feel very strongly that the hots are getting hotter, the dries are getting drier. When we're having heat domes, the likes of which we've never seen in our history, the hottest August ever in the history of the state, the ferocity of these fires, the drought 5-plus years, losing 163 million trees to that drought, something's happened to the plumbing of the world. And we come from a perspective, humbly, where we submit the science is in and observed evidence is self-evident, that climate change is real, and that is exacerbating this.
Governor Newsom said 57% of California's forests are on federal land, compared to just 3% that is owned by California, the rest privately owned. Well, today we look at California's history of forest management and how a century of fire suppression has made the current climate fires even more destructive. Fire is a natural part of life in California. For thousands of years, Native American tribes would regularly burn the landscape to steward the land. But colonization led to the suppression of these tactics and decades of misguided policy. For more on this history and how a return to indigenous stewardship of the land could foster greater climate resiliency, we go to Chico, California, where we're joined by Don Hankins, a pyrogeographer and Plains Miwok fire expert. He's a professor of geography and planning at California State University, Chico. Welcome to Democracy Now! It's great to have you with us, Professor Hankins. Can you talk about what's happening in California now? Trump saying it's just two words, it's forest management. And then Gavin Newsom saying, yeah, we also have to weigh climate change in this, but forest management is a major issue. Professor Hankins.
Right. Yeah, good morning, Amy and Juan. I think the situation in California at present, we have over 3 million acres ablaze over a very short period of time. And I think that the political jargon that's being pushed around right now is really an unfortunate situation, given the situation in the state. There's aspects of both what the president and the governor are saying are definitely correct. It's not just a one-piece solution. Forest management is definitely a part of the problem, although climate change is something that's happening, and we have to recognize that. So when we think about what's going on in our region, particularly, you know, throughout the state of California and the West Coast at this point, we have prolonged drought. The governor mentioned 5 years. I would say that it's at least going on 20 years of drought. We've had some punctuated time periods with some rain that has come in, like 2017 and 2018. But the rain that we have is not enough to saturate the ground and allow for the groundwater recharge that is so important for our landscape to thrive and be healthy. And then we add to that the accumulation of fuels within that landscape and so forth, and the inability to put fire at the scale that it really needs to be, that is such a huge part of this problem.
And Professor Hessens, could you talk about the if you can, about the difference between federal policies on the federally owned lands and state policies? Because after all, as Governor Newsom mentioned, most of the forest land is federal land. In fact, almost half of all of California is federally owned land, and 53% of Oregon is federally owned land. How is the federal government dealing with its own policies of managing these forests?
Right. Well, that's a really interesting question. So when we think about that ownership, when we talk about like state ownership of land, that state ownership is not really owned by the state, but a lot of that's privately owned land. So, you know, as a lot of rural communities, we have a lot of different landowners who are there on those lands. And within the state's fire responsibility, what we call the state responsibility area, the SRA, CAL FIRE under the Department of forestry and fire protection is that entity that has the ability to steward over it. On the federal lands, obviously, Forest Service, National Park Service, Bureau of Land Management, et cetera, all are part of that piece. And there's different policies in terms of the way that fire is allowed to be used in those places. So when we think about the federal fire policy aspect, the National Wildland Coordinating Group and other entities within the federal government allow for the integration of policies. And so some of those policies include let burn policies and allowed for wildland fire use, where, as within the state, when fires happen, CAL FIRE is mandated to put those fires out. So those are some of the differences that are there between those areas. But I think the bottom line is really coming down to the amount of acreage that we're allowed to see burn on an annual basis, but then also how much money is being put into those efforts. And I would say it's pretty minuscule. For instance, when we think about what the targets were for the Forest Service within this particular timeframe of this year, I want to say it was about 500,000 acres, so 500,000 acres of land. Obviously, with these fires, we have 3 million acres currently burning or more. But nowhere are we getting close to the scale of being able to put the type of fires that historically have occurred within this landscape back into this landscape to mitigate the effects of climate change and make the landscape more resilient.
And could you talk about the history of fire suppression as a tool of colonization? There was a piece in The Guardian where journalist Susan Cagle wrote, quote, "The Spanish were the first California colonizers to prevent indigenous people from burning the land." In 1850, the U.S. government passed the Act for the Government and Protection of Indians, which outlawed intentional burning in California, even before it was a state.
Right. Those are huge policies. When we think about the early Spanish colonization in California beginning in 1769, we have missions that are established along the California coast, and those missions had very specific policies that were put down by the Spanish governor of California that forbade people from setting fires. The Spaniards were not accustomed to the idea of indigenous people burning. They saw it as a risk to their infrastructure and their way of life, and so that then put really harsh penalties upwards of death to Indian people who were setting fires. And that is a way of life. That is the way that people have lived in this landscape for millennia. And that tool began to be removed from the toolbox of Native people. And then when we add to the American colonization, as you point out, 1850, the state hadn't even really become a state yet. We had policies within the state that also forbid the use of fire by indigenous populations, and the same kinds of penalties were applied. So reluctantly, you know, people would not obviously be able to set fires if their life was on the line for it. And so we see a real decline in the use of fire and the inability for people to access land to tend to those, which had gone on for many thousands of years through past climate change events.
So what has to happen right now, Professor Hankins? And talk about your own family from the Delta area, from the San Francisco Bay area, how you've seen the land change with regard to stewardship and what you want to see happen.
Right. Well, I think what we need to see happen at this point is the ability for indigenous practitioners working with others. You know, it's not just indigenous people that are able to do this. We have 40 million people living in the state. There's only, you know, 1.5% of the state's population is indigenous or Native American, I should say, based on identification. We have a lot of people from out of the state, too. But I think it's important that if we all work together and we use the same mindset in terms of process, you know, being able to use fire within the landscape, we can start to put fire back in at the scale that it needs to be for the right ecological and cultural purposes within the landscape to create the same outcomes. And I think the process is a really big part of that. So when, you know, we ask the question of, well, you know, how can we restore the landscape back to what it was, say, in 1769 or 1850? That's not what I'm asking for. That's not what I think needs to happen. What I say is that we, you know, climate change does happen, and the ecosystems that are here at present have a relationship with fire. And so if we put that same type of fire that those systems had evolved in back into them, and we're stewarding them in the exact same way, then we're able to ensure that climate resiliency in those landscapes, but also ensure the biodiversity the carbon capture and all the other attributes of what we maybe call ecosystem services as part of that to make those beneficial. So in terms of the Delta region in San Francisco Bay Area, for instance, you know, we have a lot of landscape change that has happened. We've got a lot of areas under that time period of 1850 to the present that was turned under the plow. So wetlands, riparian forests, you know, emergent marshes, grasslands, vernal pools, chaparral ecosystems, they all are part of those landscapes, but a lot of those places have been very heavily impacted. So one thing that I particularly focus in on in my research is how we can use fire as a conservation tool, which is part of that indigenous set of ways of burning. And when we think about like California's Valley Oak Woodlands, where there's only like 2% remaining throughout the entire state, that's an endangered ecosystem. And with, you know, small pockets of 100 acres here or 200 acres there, if fire gets into those places, we lose the diversity of those forests. We lose those forests and we lose the carbon that's captured in them. So those are the places that I tend to focus in on in a lot of my work. But that work also then extends from those wetland areas all the way to the tops of the Sierras and the mountains that feed into the system. So it's an interconnected and interrelated relationship with fire.
We want to thank you so much for joining us. And personally, I mean, how are you dealing with the massive, right now, the pollution in the air? You have Los Angeles, San Francisco, Portland, Seattle, the worst air in a major city in the world, and especially the Native American tribes. What are people doing on the ground?
Yeah, well, it's a lot of people having to stay indoors at this point. I will say that on my drive down to Chico this morning, I was happy to look up and see the stars, so the constellations are out there. But I will also point out that within our Native ways of thinking about it, there's benefits to smoke that we have to be aware of as well. That includes fumigation, that includes cooling of our streams for salmon and other things like that. So while we are dealing with a very toxic load of smoke right now, this is not what our indigenous fires would have created. This would have been spread throughout the year. So I think as a society, we need to get used to a little bit of smoke, but not the level of smoke that we're experiencing right now, and hopefully never get to this toxic level again.
Well, Professor Hankins, want to thank you for being with us. We want to say we also asked a scientist with the U.S. Forest Service to join us on the program, but they were told by the Forest Service they could not. They were told this by the Washington office. Don Hankins, pyrogeographer, Plains Miwok fire expert, professor of geography and planning at California State University, Chico, where he's speaking to us from. When we come back, as Amazon CEO Jeff Bezos becomes the first person in the world to be worth $200 billion, we look at how Amazon has gouged people during the pandemic, up to 1,000%. Stay with us. Kisses by Sam Phillips. This is Democracy Now!, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. As the COVID-19 pandemic keeps many of us sheltering at home and shopping online, the online giant Amazon said Monday it'll hire 100,000 more workers to meet growing demand. Amazon CEO Jeff Bezos has made an extraordinary amount of money during the crisis. He saw his personal wealth increase by $48 billion between just March and June alone. He's now the first person in the world to be worth $200 billion. Bezos has made so much, in fact, that Oxfam estimates he could give all 876,000 Amazon employees a one-time $105,000 bonus and still come away with as much money as he had before the pandemic. This comes as a new report documents how Amazon set prices for essential products during the crisis at levels that would violate price gouging laws in many states. Public Citizen found Amazon marked up some products by as much as 1,000%. For example, disposable face masks sold for $40 instead of $4. Prices shot up amidst shortages for pandemic-related supplies in February and March and are still high. This is New York Governor Andrew Cuomo announcing in early March that the state had started using prisoner labor to make hand sanitizer.
Because you can't get it on the market, and when you get it, it's very, very expensive. Also, to Purell and Mr. Amazon and Mr. eBay, if you continue the price gouging, we will introduce our product, which is superior to your product, and you don't even have the floral bouquet. So stop price gouging.
For more on this new report, price gouging, prime gouging, how Amazon raised prices to profit from the pandemic, we're joined by Alex Harmon, competition policy advocate for Public Citizen. He's author of the report, Welcome to Democracy Now! I bet it was extremely hard to get this information. Alex, can you talk about how you got it and the findings of your report?
Yeah, it was very hard. We searched for products on Amazon, and they were price gouging. This is an ongoing thing. They are doing this currently. They've been doing it throughout the pandemic, and the they is the key point. When this first started, there was a lot of talk about from Amazon and from others about third party sellers taking advantage and gouging. We heard about hand sanitizer, toilet paper, other things. And so we started looking at this to give people guidance on how they could protect themselves, how they could avoid it. And it became very clear very quickly that, yes, third-party sellers are still doing this, despite Amazon's claims of closing those accounts and removing those products. But Amazon itself is also doing this. And the distinction is on the website, when a third-party seller is selling, it says sold by that seller. And when it's Amazon selling, it says sold by Amazon. And so we focused on products that were sold by Amazon that had significant price increases. And it's very important to point out that the products we're talking about, and it's a sample of products, are deemed essential. And that is under price gouging statutes are defined as during an emergency, and then specific products that are essential to that emergency. So you're going to have water during a hurricane or during a wildfire, and in this case, hand sanitizer, PPE type products, and toilet paper, we learned.
Could you give some examples of some of the levels of the increases in prices on some of these particular products? And also, could you talk about this whole issue of how China became a big source in the months after the initial outbreak of the pandemic for some of these products?
Sure. And so one of the things we don't know is much about sourcing, right? So Amazon is not very transparent about where they're getting products, who their wholesalers are. A given product can flip back and forth between being sold by Amazon and being sold by a third party, and then the sourcing can be all over the place. And so we weren't looking at, you know, the questions of counterfeits or the questions of quality, because they just don't make that information available on their, through their search. The types of products, as I mentioned, toilet paper. We looked at toilet paper, paper towels, hand soap. And we were looking for products where there was a significant price increase. So price gouging statutes range from state to state. Most states have them, but it tends to be a minimum on the low end. A 10% increase is price gouging. In other states, it's more amorphous, but figure 25%. And so the lowest price increase we found on these products that we identified was about 50%. And then the highest, as Amy mentioned, was close to slightly over 1,000%. But so, for example, an 8-pack of paper towels was over 500% increase. And the type of increase we're talking about, what we're comparing to, Ideally, we were comparing to previous Amazon prices, so it was truly apples to apples. Where we could, we would find that product concurrently available at another national online retailer for significantly lower, and then that was what we called it was the expected price. So it's the price that others are selling it for or Amazon has previously sold it for.
Now, many people are familiar with the whole idea of war profiteering, but we're talking here about pandemic profiteering or disaster profiteering by these companies. What can be done in a situation where you're talking about an international company servicing its customers over the internet and local state price gouging laws? What needs to be done?
So if you do business in a state, and while Amazon is online, they are definitely in states with their warehouses and their distribution channels. And so they should be subject to all of the various state laws. However, we are advocating for a federal law to fill the gaps between the various state laws and the states that don't have laws. But also during the pandemic in Kentucky, the attorney general there brought some cases against some third-party sellers in partnership with Amazon, actually. And a outside group, a D.C.-based group, sued the Kentucky attorney general over their price gouging statute, arguing that its attempt to regulate online prices was, in fact, unconstitutional, as it basically was Kentucky setting the price for all states. And that they won in Kentucky. And so that, as it stands, the Kentucky statute is invalid. Other states have not had those challenges, but, you know, it's a reasonable possibility that they could if they attempt to enforce them. And so we believe it's clearer than ever that we need a federal statute. And to be clear, there is no federal crime of price gouging currently.
So I wanted to go back to this issue we raised in the lead of Bezos becoming, to say the least, the wealthiest man in the world, $200 billion, right? $200 billion he will. He's the first person in the world to have made that. Bezos has made so much, in fact, that Oxfam estimates he could give all 876,000 Amazon workers a one-time $105,000 bonus and still come away with as much money as he had before the pandemic and his price gouging. Talk more about this and also Amazon saying they're going to hire 100,000 more workers.
100,000 more workers at effectively minimum wage. It is troubling. And we focused on how Amazon presented price gouging. Amazon came out very early saying that it was unacceptable to them. Bezos himself identified this issue in his shareholders letter in April. And so our primary concern was, are they doing anything? And we would argue they're not. It has been a marketing campaign, in our view, not an actual effort to stop this process. And they would argue that there's millions of products and it's a whack-a-mole type process to try to stop this. Well, you can right now go to Amazon.com and start searching for essential products and find price gouging. This is not a whack-a-mole. This is a pervasive problem. And they're doing nothing. And so the only conclusion we can draw is they either don't care or there is a profit motivation here. And it is important to note, we were focused on Amazon as the seller, but they have arguably a greater profit motivation when it is a third-party seller engaging in this. And so the fact that third-party sellers are continuing and Amazon themselves are doing this suggests that they do not see this as a problem because they are looking to maximize profit during the pandemic.
Alex Harmon, we want to thank you for being with us with Public Citizen, author of the new report, Prime Gouging, How Amazon Raised Prices to Profit from the Pandemic. And that does it for our show. We'll link to that at democracynow.org. Democracy Now! Is produced with Renee Feltz, Mike Burke, Dina Guzder, Libby Rainey, Nermeen Sheikh, Maria Tarasena, Carla Wills, Tammy Warrenoff, Trina Nadura. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Thanks so much for joining us. Wear a mask. Stay safe.